This magic moment.
Through the country is so thrilling, standing out in front on opening night, smiling as you watch the theater filling, and there's your billing out there in light. There's no people like show people, they smile when they are low. Angels come from everywhere with lots of jack, and when you lose it, there's no attack. Where could you get money that you don't give back? Let's go on with the show.
There's no business like show business, like no business I know.
Gerry, how's that?
Where's the upstage corridor wall? Aggie, I thought I told you.
It's still too wobbly. They're putting on a couple more braces.
Well, I hope they don't make them too bulky. Our people have to be able to cross backstage behind that thing.
Well, that's what I told them. All we need is somebody breaking a leg.
Where are our players?
Going over their lines. You want them?
Of course I want them. It's only 3 days until dress rehearsal. We've got to get this show moving.
On stage, everybody!
Let's go. Louise, don't you have any work to do?
Aggie said everybody. I didn't mean you.
I'm somebody. Everybody in the play, Louise.
She should have said so.
Now, is everybody here?
Not counting Louise.
I know, Violet, I know.
Should we get on with this rehearsal?
Does she have to do that now?
Louise! What?
Do you have to do that now?
Do you want that back corridor wall, or don't you?
Is there anything else you could work on?
I guess so.
Fine. Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, let us take the action from the top of Act 3. We've wasted enough time already.
I've been ready for half an hour.
Who hasn't?
Yes, I'm sorry. I know I was late. You know, we've only got the one car, and Frank had to work late.
You should have called me. I go right by your place, Gerry.
Saul picks me up for every rehearsal.
Does Margie know that?
Oh, come on, Billy. Can't have Smitty coming by bicycle after dark.
People, can we save these charming conversations for later? We've got to get this show rehearsed.
Yes. I've been ready for half an hour, haven't I, Henry?
Yes, dear.
Yes, Polly, we are all as anxious as you are. This is a new author with a first play, and we do want to do it justice.
Justice tempered with mercy.
I happen to think it's a lovely play.
Sure, you've got the fattest part.
How dare you?
Darling, he means you have the most lines.
I know very well what he meant.
May I not remind you all that the author will be here at dress rehearsal and we still haven't even learned the third act? And what about these scripts? You should have all been off book 3 weeks ago.
I know my lines.
And I know mine.
And how about the rest of you?
So many rewrites.
No, wait until I give the signal. Okay, everybody, places for the top of Act 3. And curtain.
Oh, Lord,
please!
She does this all the time.
What? Leave the damn curtain.
curtain alone.
What you said?
That was for the actors. We're starting the act, not finishing it.
I was only trying to do my job.
No, the other way, Louise. Okay, fine. Now leave it alone.
Fine by me.
All right, from the top again.
Now?
Yes, now.
Ah, oh, Lord Dudley, you give the most charming parties in the whole of England.
You are too kind, Diana, but it is a pity Sir Percival could not be here.
Do you know I'm worried about Percival? He's never accepted an invitation to one of our parties and then not shown up. At least, not without sending word.
Is that me?
I thought you knew your lines, Billy.
No, I do. I just forget what I'm supposed to say then.
I can't stand it. Please join this on purpose. I know he is.
Relax, Polly. Billy, pay attention to your cues. Take it back a line and start again.
Well, whose line is it?
It's Polly's. Aggie, why are you still on the stage?
Because if I stay in the wings, I can't hear them.
If you heard them, why didn't you throw Billy his line?
Because you said not to throw them any lines unless they ask for them. I thought he was just pausing before speaking.
All right, all right. Aggie, get the hell off the stage.
Amram Sham.
All right, everybody, back into positions, and we'll take it from the top.
Do we have to?
Yes!
You don't have to yell.
Well, that's what you think.
Amram Shamba.
Now, can we continue with the play?
Yeah, sure.
Okay, from the top again. Violets go on.
Lord Dudley, you give the most charming parties in the whole of England.
You are too kind, Diana, but it is a pity Sir Percival could not be here.
Do you know I'm worried about Percival? He's never accepted an invitation not to come to one of our parties. No,
Go on.
To one of our parties and then not shown up? At least not without sending word.
Ah, but Lady Margaret, he might have had motor trouble.
Yes, indeed, I do hope he hasn't had an accident.
Oh, no, that's... He hasn't had an accident.
That's what I said.
No, you said he hasn't had an accident as if someone else did.
Well, should we take it from the top?
Oh, damn it.
Come on, Violet. Okay. Yes, indeed, I do hope he hasn't had an accident. These roads can be treacherous at night. Begging your pardon, my lord, but should we delay dinner any longer?
No, I think not. Can't wait for Percival forever. Shall we, my dear?
I suppose so, but don't you think someone ought to call Percival's flat and ascertain the reason for his absence?
Do you know, that might be a sound idea. There is something distinctly odd about all of this.
All of what, Billy?
Violet, you did it again!
Did what, huh?
You call me by my real name. I'm Stephen Sellers. And you? You're Diana Lassiter. Is that so hard to remember?
Billy, do you mind?
Sorry, Gerry.
Violet, go on.
All of what, Stephen?
Line?
This business about Percival...
Okay, I got it. This business about Sir Percival and the necklace. He did say he was bringing it tonight, Lady Margaret?
Well, actually, I never spoke with him directly, but there was a message delivered this morning in the post.
What, on St. Swithin's Day?
By Jove, I never thought of that. Margaret, are you certain about that message?
Why, come to think of it, no.
So you didn't receive a message?
Oh, yes, I did, but now I wonder if it actually were from Percival.
I should very much like to see that telegram.
No, you jumped the lines.
Okay, I got it. But it did come by post?
Well, I assumed it had, but...
Assumed? You mean you didn't actually see it?
Why, no.
Well, then how did you know it's content?
Content.
Why, Dr. Forbes had told me what it had said.
Is there any reason I shouldn't have?
No, of course not, old chap. Only there was no delivery of this post today...
It was not a letter, it was a telegram.
Now you say the lines, the one that you jumped before.
I should very much like to see that cablegram.
Telegram!
What difference does it make?
Well, none, but if Saul says telegram, then you have to say telegram.
What do you mean, if? I always say telegram.
I don't give a hoot now who says what. Can we get on with this disaster?
If we could just get through this thing once, we could start polishing our parts.
And when do we get the real furniture? These metal chairs are painful to work on.
But they help you polish your parts.
There, you see, he's doing it again.
Saul, will you stop with the jokes and buckle down to work, please?
I was just trying to ease the tension.
Your jokes about poly are causing the tension.
Okay, no more jokes. Now can we please get back to the play?
Louise!
I was just trying to finish the job while nobody was working.
We're about to start working.
Well, why didn't you say so? I'm gonna go make some coffee.
Fine, now. Everybody get back into positions, please, and we'll pick it up from Billy's line.
I should very much like to see that telegram.
Well, as a matter of fact, I don't have it. The message was phoned from the telegraph office.
Doris, have there been any telephone messages this evening?
See here, you insolent young pup. Are you doubting my word?
Of course he isn't, Rex. Stephen, you should apologize to Dr. Forbes.
Oh, I shall, as soon as Doris answers my question.
Come on!
What was that? Louise dropped the coffee cup tray.
You bumped it out of my hand.
The hell I did!
Did anything break?
I don't think so.
She bent the spoon.
That was bent.
Okay, ladies, would you stop it, please? Okay, let's pick it up from where we left off.
No, sir.
What?
I said no.
I know what you said. I just wasn't ready for it.
Okay, go back to Billy's line and start again.
Right. I shall as soon as Doris answers my question.
No, sir.
What? Are you quite sure?
The telephone has been out of order since this afternoon. Mum.
No, wait, Miss Smitty. That's short for madam. It doesn't mean that the telephone was keeping mum.
Oh, I see. The telephone has been out of order since this afternoon. Mum.
Aha. And what do you say to that, Dr. Forbes?
Saul, that's your cue.
Didn't we skip a page? This part is coming too early.
Aggie?
Just let me find the place. What page are you on?
Well, I don't have my script. I was so anxious to get the car that when Frank came home, I just took off without thinking.
You know, I think Saul's right. I think we went right from page 3-2 to 3-4. Who's got a complete script?
I've got it. It's page 3-3. Saul was right. We skipped the whole part about the diamond necklace.
Well, how come I don't have that page?
Oh, I must have miscounted when I was making the copies. Does everybody else have it?
Yes.
Okay, then let's go back and do the page that we left out.
Well, how can I follow along if I don't have the page?
Here, take my script. I've got the lines down cold if I ever get the chance to say them.
Say, while we're stopped, I actually have a question. It's about the play's title. Isn't this title already a steal from something else? I think this is from an old Agatha Christie movie.
I don't think Phyllis Montague would steal a movie title, Billy.
There's no way she could. No one can copyright a title. It's the law. There just aren't enough words to go around to name things.
I mean, even if that's true, just what about the advertising of our show? Like, won't some people think that this play is from Agatha Christie?
So much the better for our box office.
And it is a murder mystery, so no one gets hurt.
Doesn't sound like much of a murder mystery if no one gets hurt.
Yeah, I thought Sir Percival gets bumped off by Dr. Forbes. Okay, hold it, all of you. Did we come here tonight to rehearse or to discuss originality versus plagiarism?
All right, you know what? Gerry's right. Let's get back to work. I'm sorry I interrupted you.
Well, which line do we go back to?
Yeah, where does the necklace come in anyhow?
Okay, I see what happened. Smitty, you came in too early.
Oh, I did. But I thought I was supposed to enter when Violet says the line about the treacherous roads.
You're almost right. It's the line about the lecherous toads.
I'm sorry, but they sound pretty much the same.
Yeah, Phyllis Montague fancies herself a poet.
She is a poet, a rare talent, and a great writer.
Would you say that if she had you playing a mute? Now see here!
Okay, stop it, all of you.
Okay, Smitty, pay attention, and this is important. You mustn't take your cues from the words alone. Pay attention to the plot, then you'll know when to make your entrances. Even if Violet says the line wrong, do you understand?
But I didn't say the line wrong.
You didn't say your line at all.
Well, how could I when Smitty came in?
All right. That is enough. Do your arguing on your own time.
Coffee's ready.
Finally, I could use a cup,
but we've barely gotten started.
Listen, maybe a break is a good idea. Let's just all grab a cup, come on back, take this thing from the top and do it right. Okay, Aggie, don't go yet. I want to talk to you. I'm getting very worried about our progress.
What progress?
I know what you mean. We've never been this far behind on a show.
It's not your fault, Gerry. We've also never had the illustrious author in our hair before either. Phyllis keeps rewriting the damn script while the cast is still trying to learn it.
She promised no more changes, Aggie.
What do you want to bet she's going to show up here with 7 new pages?
I mean, we haven't even learned the last batch of rewrites.
Small wonder the way Polly keeps inviting Phyllis over for dinner and getting her part fattened. It's almost as big as she is now.
Well, don't you start with the fat jokes, Aggie. I'm having enough trouble with Saul.
Still, if Polly had it her way, this show would be a one-woman monologue.
I mean, at least Phyllis is letting us do her show for free.
Naturally. Who's going to pay money for it?
Be fair, Aggie. I mean, it's not that bad.
I guess, but if Polly keeps padding her part...
Oh, she won't. I'll put my foot down. It's only 3 days until dress rehearsal. We'll be lucky to learn the lines that we've got.
I suppose you're right. You know, some of the mistakes tonight are better than the original lines. If you just let the cast alone, this show could be a riot.
Aggie, Murder Most Foul is not a comedy. Phyllis Montague would scream if the audience started laughing at it. She'd pass right out on the floor.
Well, then you'd better have the smelling salts handy for opening night.
Oh, Aggie. Is there anything left in the pot?
Not if you're lucky.
I heard that, Saul Watson.
Then let it be a lesson to you, Louise Peary.
Well, I hope we get this act done tonight. 3 days to dress rehearsal, and we still haven't had a full run through.
You can thank your friend, Phyllis, for that.
Oh, you mustn't blame Phyllis, Billy. She's simply a perfectionist.
If she wasn't satisfied with the script, then why did she submit it?
Because if we'd picked some other show, then she'd have had to wait till next year to get this done.
Well, why couldn't it be our next show?
We've already got our audiences preconditioned.
Brainwashed is more like it.
Oh, yeah, that's putting it rather strongly, Saul.
That's the unvarnished truth. We never vary season after season. We do a musical, a mystery, a comedy, and a drama in that order without fail.
Yes, but why?
That's how we started the company, and it's just gotten to be a habit for us and our patrons.
Well, what would be the harm if we mixed it up?
It would confuse people. The comedy fans would show up to the drama and start laughing at all the tragic moments, and the musical fans would start beating time to the comedy.
Or sob during the mystery.
Oh, they still might do that.
Aggie, whose side are you on anyway?
On the side of sanity. It doesn't do me much good around here.
Well, I'm all set. Anybody else ready to give it a go?
Oh, relax, Saul. We're all much too tense tonight. Why do we keep snapping at each other the way we do? This close to opening night, we're usually kidding around and we're having a marvelous time.
If you want my opinion, we're running scared.
Scared of what?
In our own way, Smitty, we're just as perfection-oriented as our author. We want the show to be a smash, not a smash-up.
Amen.
Oh, we'll get it. Somehow, no matter how awful the show looks in rehearsal, we always manage to pull it off.
That's with a printed script, Polly. I mean, this typewritten stuff is okay, don't get me wrong. It's all the revisions that are killing us.
But Phyllis gave her solemn word.
It's the only kind of word she knows. I'll bet she's never giggled in her life.
And she promised the same thing last week, Polly, and then she showed up on Monday with 3 new scenes.
I wish she wouldn't keep changing the identity of the murderer. I don't know whether to radiate menace or chum the pants off everybody.
Well, you're not going to do either just standing there. Okay, come on, everybody, let's keep moving. Let's see if we can take this thing straight through to the curtain without stopping.
We better. I've got to get home and study for a biology exam.
Wait, Smitty. Gerry, should we take this from the top, or...?
Why don't we take it from Violet's line, where Smitty made the entrance too soon, and do the pace that we left out?
I forgot what my line is.
Aggie, throw her cue.
Just let me find the place.
Okay, I found it. Violet, I'll feed you Billy's line, then you start.
Okay.
Ah, but Lady Margaret, he might have had motor trouble.
Yes, indeed, I do hope he hasn't... No, wait, I'll get it.
Oh, I certainly hope so.
Oh, Polly, stop it. Violet, go on.
Yes, indeed, I do hope he hasn't had an accident. These roads can be treacherous at night.
Is that where I put in?
No, that was treacherous. You're waiting for lecherous.
Yeah, sorry.
Well, who does have the next line?
It's Polly's.
Oh, let me see.
It's don't say such a thing.
No, don't tell me. I'll get it.
I certainly hope so.
Oh, for the love of God.
I've got it. Violet, would you?
Roads can be treacherous at night.
Don't say such a thing. It would make one think that there was some truth, after all, to that story about the curse.
Oh, nonsense, my dear. There is no such thing as a curse.
And yet, anyone who has ever owned the Delhi Diamond... Gerry, do we really have to call it that? It sounds like it comes from a delicatessen.
That's because you're not pronouncing the H, Billy. It's Delhi, not Delhi.
Polly, the H is silent. It is pronounced Delhi, not Delhi.
Can we please go on? I've got to get home and study for that exam.
Wait, hold on, Smitty. Billy does have a point. I mean, it does sound like it belongs next to the liverwurst. It looks okay when you read it in the script, but it sounds just plain silly.
Okay, so call it the Calcutta Diamond.
You can't do that. Phyllis Montague told me particularly that she chose that name for its lovely alliteration, Delhi Diamond.
Okay, so we'll alliterate. Let's call it the Calcutta Carbuncle.
Carbuncle?
Yeah, it's a big stone like a ruby, a garnet cut, what you call it, a cabochon.
It sounds like a big zit.
So do you.
Saul, stop it. I mean, there must be some other gem they can use.
Well, you shouldn't tamper with Phyllis's dialogue. She won't like it.
She'll like it a lot less if her Delhi Diamond gets a laugh.
Jerry's right, dear. We should have another name for it.
Well.
Listen, I've got it. Let's call it the Rancher for Ruby.
Hey, I like that. That's got class.
But whatever will we tell Phyllis?
Tell her she rewrote it that way. She's done enough revisions, she'll probably believe it.
Well, in the meantime, let's hope so. Okay, can we get on with the play now?
Yes.
Okay, all right, where was I?
Hey, Gerry, should I write in that change or not?
Yes, but do it in pencil just in case.
Gotcha. Well, how do you spell Rancher?
Make it! Nobody has to read it but you!
Amramshama!
Okay, Billy, go ahead with your line. It's the one right after Lord Dudley scoffs at the curse.
Right. And yet, anyone who has ever owned the Rancher for Ruby has always met with a dreadful demise.
There, you see? I knew there was a reason for Phyllis's words. It's double alliteration. Delhi Diamond and Dreadful Demise.
Oh, who gives a damn?
See, here now, you can't talk to my wife like that.
Henry, for once, I agree with Saul. Who gives a damn? Billy, go on.
Right. And yet anyone who has ever owned the Rancher for Ruby has always met with a rotten requiem.
Come on, Billy, now you sound like an elocution teacher.
So does Phyllis Montague!
Oh, no, really.
It double alliterates, doesn't it?
Billy, don't. Just leave the lines ending as written, please.
Okay. Has always met with a dreadful demise.
Oh, that's my line. But Percival no longer owns the diamond, the ruby, anymore. Not since he sold it to Lord Dudley for Lady Margaret's collection.
Nevertheless, Percival did own it, and that might be enough.
See here, Dr. Forbes, you are a man of science. Surely you don't believe in curses?
I only know there are strange things in the history of India. Things which defy rational explanation.
Nonsense! Sheer poppycock! Superstitious drivel!
Quite possibly, Lord Dudley. And yet?
And yet?
Where is Sir Percival?
Well, frankly, I'm glad he isn't here.
Why, Diana, what a thing to say.
I mean it. Sir Percival is no gentleman.
See here now. What are you saying?
Every time he looks at me, I feel as though his hands were moving all over my body.
But he is a knight of the realm.
He is a disgusting toad, and such toads can be lecherous at night.
Begging your pardon, my lord, but should we delay dinner any longer?
Louise, what are you doing?
Isn't that what a phone rings?
Wait.
If she does that, turn two pages at once. I'm sorry. If she does that the night of the performance.
She won't, Polly. She won't. Louise, you've got to be more careful.
Well, look on the bright side. Now we know the phone bell works.
Louise.
That woman, I could just...
No, you couldn't. Louise is a black belt in karate.
And how do you know I don't?
They only go up to a size 44.
Saul!
Now, honey, you mustn't be so hasty about this.
I was only kidding.
What was that crash?
I better go apologize.
What are we gonna do now?
Well, we can't work around her. She's got herself in damn near every scene.
Not the love scene in Act 2. Maybe we can do that one.
Well, couldn't we wait until we got the real sofa? I mean, those chairs are awfully hard to cuddle on.
Aggie, when do we get the sofa?
We should have had it 2 days ago.
Can you call and find out?
I could try.
You want to take a look at that back quarter wall, Gerry?
Yes, I'm getting worried about those braces.
You and me both. I've got 6 2x4s on that thing already, and it still flaps like a sail.
Well, I'll guess I'll go hit the old biology book.
You've got it here?
Why not? All the time I spend waiting to make my entrance, I could study for 3 exams.
Well, Violet, what do you say?
Oh, all right. Ready when you are.
On your mark, get set. Oh, Diana, I was just seeking Lady Margaret.
Well, Lady Margaret is cutting roses in the garden, Stephen. She may not return for some time.
I see. Would you mind if I waited for her here?
Well, naturally not.
And might I sit?
If you are so inclined.
Diana?
Yes, Stephen?
Would you take it too offense if I were to...
Stephen, what are you trying to say?
Dash it all, Diana. Must we play at words? You know the message that longs to cry out from within my heart.
Is it possible? Do I dare dream that the message within your heart is the self-same message that cries out from within my own?
Diana, do you mean... Do I dare dream?
Have a care, sir. Have a care. You know I am betrothed to another man.
And yet, you do not draw away?
Well, can you not reason out why?
I am almost afraid to.
Then cease your noble trepidations, my dear Stephen Sellers. For although I am a high-born lady, I'm also a woman.
Oh, Diana.
If Dr. Forbes were to come upon us...
Hang your illustrious fiancé. He shall not have you. Oh, Diana.
Oh, Billy, what?
Oh, Violet.
What is all that? Now I know why you want the real sofa.
Louise!
I didn't see a thing, not a thing.
Billy, do you think she suspects?
I mean, how could she? I mean, I didn't suspect myself until just a moment ago.
Oh, darling. Neither did I.
Yeah!
Phyllis, she promised she wouldn't come back until after the dress rehearsal.
Did you all hear what I just heard?
Oh, that sounded like Phyllis.
Probably with 5 new pages of dialogue for you.
I just accepted 1 apology from you, Saul. Do you want to have to make another?
Sorry, Polly.
How are you all?
Why, Phyllis, we weren't expecting you, at least not tonight.
Oh, I know I'm being a naughty girl, Geraldine, but I have so many new and good things to share with you all that I simply couldn't wait until dress rehearsal.
Well, that's a mercy.
More changes? Phyllis, we open in 4 nights.
That's why I decided not to wait until dress rehearsal to stop by. This would be much too much to have to learn in 1 night.
What makes you think we can learn it in 3?
Oh, don't be a tease, Henry. It's really all very simple.
I simply added just one extra character and cut the love scene.
Wait, cut the love scene?
Perhaps I'm putting it too strongly. It's not precisely cut, just cut out of Act 2 and move back to Act 1.
Oh, all right. I mean, I guess that's not so bad.
Except it's no longer between Diana and Stephen.
Then between who?
Yeah, the Lord and Lady are already married.
You can't mean the doctor and the maid, can you?
Perhaps I didn't make myself clear. Diana still plays the scene, but now it's with Sir Percival.
How
did you do that?
Well, I got to thinking that perhaps a knight of the realm was a better catch for Diana than a marriage commoner like Stephen's. So.
Phyllis, I didn't say why. I said, how can you do it? We don't have a Sir Percival in the play.
Exactly. Everybody refers to him all the time, but he never actually appears.
Besides, it's kind of rough on Diana if you make that switch, considering that I bump off Percival before I show up at the house.
Oh, shoot, she's coming on the stage.
You do?
Phyllis! Don't you even know your own plot?
Yes, but I don't recall a murder. Show me where it says so.
We never actually see it happen, because after Sir Percival has vanished and Rex has the missing necklace, we then figured out who killed him. Does that make sense?
Murder. I never thought of it as a murder. I just thought, well, Rex picked Percival's pocket and perhaps drained all the petrol from the tank of his car to keep him from the party. I mean, after all, murder is so
popular with our patrons.
And we're already advertising it as a murder mystery.
And we open in 4 nights. Phyllis, for Pete's sake, it's a bit late to start auditioning Percival's.
Oh, but I've written you all the loveliest new lines. Oh, won't you at least have a look at them?
Sure.
Come on, you guess.
All right, pass it.
Can't be that bad, right?
Here, Paula.
I'm pregnant.
What?
Not me. Diana is. But who's the father?
That's on the third sheet.
Lord Dudley.
Henry.
Polly, don't be an idiot.
Well, it was a bit of a shock.
This is crazy. Phyllis, what about the ending? I mean, how can Lord Dudley be the father if he and Diana had only just met?
That's on the 15th.
Amnesia!
Yes, because that explains why he doesn't remember their meeting.
But if she's carrying his child, Diana must remember something.
No, that's explained on page 7. You see, it was a very dark night.
Phyllis, this is totally ridiculous. The entire thrust of the plot has been altered. Everybody has a brand new motivation for what they do.
Well, surely with a little work. In the next 4 days?
We couldn't do it in 4 months.
But I worked so hard.
And we haven't. There's no way we can make these changes at this late a date.
But they're just little changes.
I mean, if Stephen and Diana get married, won't that put a cramp in all their festivities?
Well, I'm working on that.
More changes? Phyllis Montague, do you have any notion how hard it is to do a play? Even a play that hasn't changed direction every 3 days. This script should have been finalized 3 weeks ago.
What's this? Lady Margaret goes into shock at the news of Diana's pregnancy and loses the power of speech?
My mother insisted on reading over the script because she didn't want me in a play full of sex. If Diana's pregnant, then I have to quit the show.
Oh, but she's only 2 months pregnant. I mean, it's not like she's got a show.
Mother thinks ahead.
Well, of course, if you'd all rather not do my little play.
Now, hold it right there, Phyllis. We all appreciate the chance to do a play for which we do not have to pay royalties for. In fact, doing your show would put the theater budget in the black for the first time in 6 months.
However, when the play reading committee agreed to do this show of yours, it was on the basis of the original script. Now that play we promised to do and we'll do it, but all this new stuff was not part of that arrangement.
Are you telling me that you now feel free to reject my play?
Not the script as it was first submitted. And I'll even allow you all the alterations you've already made, Phyllis. But this last batch is just too much.
Do you have the authority to speak for the entire committee?
Yes.
Come on, Cassie. Come on. Man up.
No. But when I tell them it's either the first version or no version, I'll have their unanimous backing.
Right. Well, of course, if you really feel strongly about this matter, dear Geraldine. Polly? How do you feel about it?
Well, it is rather close to opening night, Phyllis, and, well, you know, of course.
Remember, she cut all your speeches.
I'm with Gerry.
Me too.
All right, go ahead and do the original version. But if the show's reviews turn out to be a box office disaster, well.
We'll all remember who wrote the original.
Do you think maybe we were a little rough on her?
Well, she did take it rather hard.
She said once at dinner that she looks upon this play as her child.
It's the only offspring she'll ever have.
And when she tried to make that child just a little prettier.
I really wish you hadn't put it that way.
Gerry, don't be a sap. Phyllis wasn't making the child prettier. She was giving it an extra head.
You're right. Let's leave the kid alone and learn to love it as is.
All right, now you're talking.
Well, we came here to rehearse, so let's rehearse.
I'm giving you all to the count of three, and if I don't hear some snappy dialogue, I'm getting out the hammer.
And I'll hold the nails.
Right.
I need another cup of coffee. All you people pick up those long faces and get into character.
Should we take it from the top?
Not if you want to get home sometime before dawn. Why don't you pick up from Saul's line about the telegraph office and go from there?
Right.
Name me your line again, Billy?
No, we're going from Saul.
Oh, we're going from Saul. Okay.
Well, as a matter of fact, I don't have it. The message was phoned from the telegraph office.
Doris, have there been any telephone messages this evening?
See here, you insolent young pup. Are you doubting my word?
Of course he isn't, Rex. Stephen, you should apologize to Dr. Ford.
Oh, I shall, as soon as Doris answers my question.
No, sir.
What? Are you quite sure?
The telephone has been out of order since this afternoon, Mum.
Aha! And what do you say to that, Dr. Forbes?
Does that answer your question?
Stephen, I believe you owe Dr. Forbes an apology.
Doris, you had best answer that before we owe the caller an apology, too.
Yes, sir. Hello?
Who? Why, yes, he is. Just a moment. It's for you, sir.
Who is it?
Sir Percival.
Can't be. I mean...
Yes, doctor? What exactly do you mean?
Why, I...
Hello? Yes? I see. Yes, I see. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Why, Dudley, you look so strange. What did Percival say?
Just one moment.
What? Did we do something wrong?
No, of course not. I wanted to see what you were all doing when the phone rang. Can you just take it back a second, please?
Gerry, it's a long way to the end of the act. Do you think
this will only take a moment? Just take it back to Smitty's line about the phone and go from there.
Okay. Sure.
The telephone has been out of order since this afternoon, Mum.
Aha! And what do you say to that, Dr. Forbes?
Louise! Sorry, I hit the wrong cue. Hang on. Now I got it.
Aha! And what do you say to that, Dr. Forbes?
Oh! Oops, wrong place!
And we opened it 4 nights!
I'll get it!
Oh,
curtain open.
There's a draft up here. The curtain keeps some of it out.
Well, that's because someone left the front door open. I closed it.
Why are theaters always so drafty backstage?
They're designed that way on purpose. The breeze comes in handy if the play smells.
I don't suppose you have any particular play in mind, Aggie?
Don't say I didn't warn you.
Gerry, do we have to wear makeup tonight?
Well, I don't care so much about the men, but I do want to see how the women look, especially their hairdos.
I think they're using wigs.
I've seen the wigs. I want to see how they look wearing them.
All right, I'll tell them.
How do you like the wall?
Well, it looks okay on this side, but how much space is there to cross behind it?
If everyone's careful, there's about 2 inches clearance on either side. Except for Polly, of course.
Oh. How is she gonna get from the garden to the prop table backstage to pick up the roses she brings on stage?
Oh, she doesn't have to. I put the roses on that side of the stage. I told her it was to simplify things for her, but I didn't tell her what I was simplifying.
That's good thinking. We have to keep her in a happy mood. She nearly walked out again last night thanks to Saul Watson.
Well, you gotta admit, he was pretty funny.
Yes, but his sense of humor cost us a half hour. I finally got him to agree. He would say that Lord Dudley was going to go off and have a talk with Lady Margaret, not chew the fat with her.
Even if he behaves himself in rehearsal, how do we know how he's going to act during the performance?
I don't even want to think about it. I'm already having nightmares.
I'm surprised you can sleep at all. You know, tomorrow night this whole thing will be out of your hands. All you can do then is stand in the wings and pray. There's not enough room to kneel.
Maybe I'll just spend opening night in some cozy little bar in another town.
What do you think of this thing, Gerry? It looks real, doesn't it?
It certainly does. It was awfully nice of Phyllis to lend this to us for the show. Costume jewelry this good can be awfully expensive.
Have you figured out yet what to do about this central stone? You know, you haven't told Phyllis you've nixed her whole Delhi diamond idea. How are you going to pass this thing off as a ruby?
As a matter of fact, Billy came up with the perfect solution for that. From now on, it's going to be known as the White Ruby of Ranchipur.
Is there such a thing as a white ruby?
Well, there is now. And please, please, Louise, keep that safe between performances. We wouldn't want it to get picked up or stolen.
Don't worry. I figure this necklace is our ace in the hole. Phyllis will preoccupy herself worrying about it instead of the play.
There's something to that, all right.
Yeah, you know what, though? I'd feel a lot better if that safe had a back to it. You know, anybody could just walk right up behind that flat and pick that necklace right up.
Well, I can nail one on, but I'd have to take the safe off first, and that would mean repainting the whole flat.
Why would you have to take the safe off?
Well, if I hammer on the back and the front's where it is, the whole thing's gonna tear loose from the flat and fall on the stage.
Tell you what, I'm not doing much once the curtain's up except prompting. Why don't I hang on to the thing, and then when Saul reaches into the safe, I'll just hand it to him.
Would you, Aggie? It would set my mind at ease.
Not a problem.
Well, you better practice it then, because tonight is your only night. a chance before opening.
Of course, but the practice couldn't hurt.
You ready for the mob yet?
Yes, I mean, I might as well. Only if they're all in costumes.
Well, if they're not, it's their own tough luck. Hey, everybody on stage!
All right. Okay, everybody line up, please. I want you all to line up in front of the stage. Okay, I want you all in this order. I would like Saul, then next to Saul, I want Violet, then Polly, Henry, then could I have Billy and Smitty at the end? I want to see how all the costumes look. Okay, they seem to fit all right.
I think mine is just a little bit too small.
I didn't say a word.
And you better not.
Okay, you know what? Be fair, Polly. It's one thing if he says something, but if you're going to blow up entirely, if you think he might say something...
Yes, you're right. Sorry, Saul. Rehearsal jitters, I guess.
No problem.
Okay, now everybody turn around slowly. I want to see how it looks from the back. Okay. All right.
Okay, wait, hold on. Violet, why aren't you wearing a bustle like Polly?
I'm not wearing a bustle.
Oh, I am so, Polly, I am so sorry.
You're sorry?
Yes. Stop. Okay. Wait, Violet, why aren't you wearing that wig?
Oh, it's too big. Look, let me show you. See, I look like a British sheepdog.
Okay, well, can't you pat it or take a tuck into it or something?
I'll think of something. I didn't have the time just yet.
Okay, well, you know what? You're all gonna look just fine. Well, let's now see how well you can all act.
Places for act one?
Yes, I mean, we might as well get started.
You want to do it with the curtains?
Yes, I want everything exactly as if this were a performance.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, damn it.
Gerry, I think you just got your wish.
In spades.
Oh, Geraldine, I have the most dreadful news. We're going to have to change the name of my play.
What? What, Phyllis? The publicity's been mailed out. The programs have all been printed.
But we must. I just discovered that there's a movie with the same title. Murder.
Phyllis, no one in the audience is likely to be confused. They can see that this isn't a movie.
Right. In a movie, no one forgets their lines.
Don't say things like that, Saul. I'm having enough trouble already.
Oh, I do hope you're joking, Marla.
Who? Oh, I almost forgot your real name, Smitty.
Yeah, no one ever uses it, except my mother.
And Phyllis.
Oh, but I think nicknames are so vulgar, Saul, don't you?
I'm the wrong guy to ask, Phil.
Phyllis! I am so glad that you are here tonight, because you can be a great help to us all.
Really?
How? Why, you can listen to all the lines and make sure that everybody is saying them properly.
And where does that leave me?
Well, not the words exactly, Aggie, but all the subtle little nuances of their interpretations.
You mean the ones you keep forgetting to tell me to write down?
Yes.
Shall I sit up there beside you?
No! I take, you know, just so many notes during rehearsal. I don't want to be a distraction to you.
Louise, have you got a chair back there for our playwright?
If you've got a dust rag.
This is thrilling! Simply thrilling!
Yeah.
You got any other nice little surprises for us? Because I could use a thrill right now.
It'll be okay, Saul. Don't lose your temper.
What the hell are nuances?
Don't ask. Just grit your teeth and pray you got them.
I thought you wanted to go straight through without any interruptions, but Phyllis back there listening for nuances.
Cheer up. Maybe Louise will drop a sandbag on her.
I'm ready!
Okay! Louise, close the curtain and we'll get started.
You want the music too?
Yes, Louise, I want everything like this was an actual performance.
Everybody hold your places during the music.
I'm off stage when the curtain rises. I don't have a place.
You're lucky.
Quiet, everybody.
Louise, the house lights. Dim the house lights. Yes, perfect. Just like that. I want it just like that before the music starts.
Gotcha.
Lord Dudley, will there be anyone at dinner tonight besides Sir Percival, the famous archaeologist, Dr. Rex Forbes, the famous scientist, and Stephen Sellers, the famous millionaire?
Other than myself and Lady Margaret, my wife, and the lovely socialite Diana Lassiter here, no Doris.
That's what I thought.
I say, Diana, have you yet located that book on the famous jewels of India that I told you must be there on the table?
Ah, yes, here it is. I say, Lord Dudley, you didn't tell me that there was a curse on the famous white ruby of Ranjabur.
But what?
It's all right, Phyllis, it's all right.
But that's supposed to be the Delhi diamond.
We had to change it, Phyllis.
For what possible reason?
It looks silly next to the liverwurst.
What? Liverwurst? There's no liverwurst in my play.
We wanted to keep it that way.
I beg your pardon.
Phyllis.
Please trust me. Now, just go off the stage and Aggie will explain the change to you.
But
you... Please, Phyllis, we open tomorrow night.
Well, I...
Very well, very well.
Go on with the show, people.
From the top? I already put the feather duster
away. No, right from where we broke.
Right. Violet, would you?
Oh, yes. The famous white ruby of Ranchipole.
Oh, fiddlesticks. A lot of hogwash. Damn superstitious rot.
But the book distinctly says that Lord Clyde Fortescue, the first owner of the white ruby of Ranchipole.
Gerry, can't I just say ruby? I hate to say the whole mouthful every time.
Yes, just go on.
Okay. The book distinctly says that Lord Clyde Fortescue, the first owner of the ruby, was found floating in his tub in his own blood. And then the next owner, Sir Giles Renfrew, had no sooner purchased the ruby from Lord Clyde's estate when he was found trampled to death by his favorite horse. And then the next owner...
Balderdash! Nonsense! A lot of old wives' tales!
How can it be? They are all dead, aren't they?
Yes, but consider I bought the ruby just this morning, and I'm fine.
Lord Dudley, is anything wrong?
No, nothing. Just another one of my beastly attacks.
How long have you had them?
Since this morning.
You don't suppose...
No, ridiculous. Sheerest coincidence, merest chance.
Dr. Forbes is here, Lord Dudley.
It is your fiancé, Diana. You know, that's a pretty dumb line, isn't it? I mean, she knows he's her fiancé.
But the audience doesn't.
Why don't I just wear a signboard?
Now, really, Saul.
People, will you quit your gabbing and get on with the show? It's far too late to make alterations now.
All right. It is your fiancé, Diana.
Yes, being engaged to the world's famous scientist has made me the envy of all the girls in England.
Ah, but a lovely belle like you deserves to have a ring.
Speaking of dumb lines...
Violet! That line is supposed to be lighthearted. The merriment provides emotional contrast with the atmosphere of terror.
Yeah, that's the general atmosphere, all right?
Will you all just please?
Yes. You flatter me, Lord Dudley.
Doris, would you show the gentleman in?
At once, my lord.
Lord Dudley, Diana. I see you two lovers would like to be alone. I'll just toddle off to my room and putter about.
Not that exit, Henry. That goes to the kitchen and the maid's quarters.
Right. Of course, she is quite a good-looking maid.
Henry!
Just joking, my dear.
You mean I'm not good-looking?
Henry, just say your line and go.
Saul has a line first.
I have?
Oh, right. Really, Lord Dudley, you needn't go.
Oh, nonsense. I was once in love myself.
Why does he say that in the past tense?
Polly, please.
Sorry.
My dearest darling.
Mwah, my sweet. Mwah.
My darling, I have a little surprise. Oh, damn.
What's the matter?
Forgot the stupid necklace. Aggie!
Here, sorry about that. Aggie, as stage manager, you're supposed to make certain that everybody has their props.
I know, but I was backstage and Phyllis was talking to me about nuances that I missed Saul's entrance.
Phyllis, you really mustn't chat backstage while people have work to do.
I do apologize, Geraldine. I forgot Agnes had things to do.
My fault for not reminding her. Agnes.
Pick it up from where we left off.
Good as bad as any.
My darling, I have a little surprise. The white ruby of Ranchipa.
How incredibly lovely it is, might I, Triton?
Not afraid of the curse?
Well, not very much, may I please?
Certainly you shall. Here, allow me. It is lovely in such a lovely setting.
Oh, Rex, what a thing to say.
I cannot decide which is lovelier, you or that fabulous gem.
I simply must see myself in it. Let me find a mirror.
Diana! That necklace. How dare you take it off at once?
Lady Margaret, I was only...
Take it off, I say, this instant.
Here now, Lady Margaret. There's surely no harm done.
No harm done, you say? How could you endanger the life of this dear girl and your own fiancé?
I don't believe in that silly curse, Lady Margaret. After all, it is the 20th century.
Diana, are you all right?
harm.
Aren't you being silly, Lady Margaret?
Well, perhaps I am, but it is better to be safe than sorry.
Should you not at least wait until Lord Dudley has seen his newest possession?
He shall see it in good time, when I feel brave enough to wear it. And don't forget, he purchased this for me. So in actuality, it is mine to do with as I please. Oh, oh dear. I put it in too far.
Do you mean to say there's no back on that thing?
My fault, my fault. I forgot I was supposed to be back there to grab the damn thing.
Aggie, I do hope you're taking notes on all these things.
I know, I just keep forgetting to read them.
We'll never be ready by tomorrow night, never. We've been here almost a whole hour and we're not even halfway through the first act.
And we've only had two rehearsals of the third, and that's the most important act in the show.
Aggie's right. This is the act that we're all pretty panicky about.
Yeah, but why don't we do that act right now? I mean, it's hard enough to do everything that comes before with that act hanging over our heads. Maybe if we were a little more confident about it.
Okay, anything to get this show nailed down. Why don't we do the third act, get our confidence up, and then run all three acts as fast as we can.
How long will that take? My mother doesn't like me out too late on a school night. I just barely passed that biology exam.
You know, the sooner we start, the sooner we can get finished. Okay, come on, everybody. Let's get into places for the top of act three.
Do you want to do it with the curtain?
Not now, Louise. Wait till we run the entire show.
Okay, but give me a minute while I find the right cue.
You've got nothing until those phone bells, Louise. Look for your spot while we're running the act.
Well, I'll do my best.
Okay, everybody, top of act three, let's go.
I got it!
Phyllis, you can't just interrupt rehearsal like that.
But I solved the problem of the liverwurst.
Oh, damn it, that's been solved already.
There's no need to use profanity, Saul.
That's what you think.
Please, hear me out. I was so concerned with the loss of my lovely double alliteration.
All right, just give us the solution, but be quick about it.
Okay. We don't have to say Delhi Diamond. We call it the Darjeeling Diamond. Do you see? It's still named after a town in India.
All right, all right. Thank you for the change. We will make the change. Now, get off my stage and I don't want to hear or see you again until we're done rehearsing this act, okay?
You don't have to get huffy about it.
Does everybody have the new name for that stupid gem?
Darjeeling Diamond, got it.
Okay, now, everybody into positions and no stopping.
What do you want to bet?
Please, Louise.
Okay, I just thought it was a great opportunity to pick up some extra cash.
Everybody into positions and no stopping. The next person who interrupts me dies. And I don't mean gets yelled at. I don't mean gets chewed out. I mean dies.
On your marks, get set, go!
Ah, Lord Dudley, you give the most charming parties in the whole of England.
You were too kind, Diana, but it is a pity Sir Percival could not be here.
Do you know I'm worried about Percival? He's never accepted an invitation to one of our parties and then not shown up, at least not without sending word.
Ah, but Lady Margaret, he might have had motor trouble.
Yes, indeed, I do hope he hasn't had an accident. These roads can be treacherous at night. Smitty!
This is all my fault. I should be providing you all with a pleasant atmosphere to work in, not strike terror into all of your hearts. So just pick it up from where you left off and slow it down a little, okay? Yeah.
Doesn't that mean you're not gonna kill Polly?
Yes, but don't you start feeling too secure, okay?
Right.
Okay. Go ahead, Polly. These roads can be treacherous at night.
My mind's blank. I can't think.
Don't say such a thing. It would make one think.
Oh, right. Oh, yes. Don't say such a thing. It would make one think that perhaps there was some truth, after all, to that story about the curse.
Nonsense, my dear. There is no such thing as a curse.
And yet, anyone who has ever owned the Delhi the Darjeeling Diamond has always met with a dreadful demise.
Beautiful! Beautiful!
Hey!
diamond anymore. Not since he sold it to Lord Dudley for Lady Margaret's correction. Connection? Confection?
Collection!
Nevertheless, Percival did own it, and that might be enough.
See here, Dr. Fobbs. Forbes.
Hey, okay, stop again.
Oh. Everybody. Everybody, okay. Everybody, take a deep breath. And relax. Okay. All right, now just go on and just, you know what, just enjoy yourselves, okay? Yeah. Okay?
You are a man of science. Surely you don't believe in curses?
I only know there are strange things in the history of India. Things which defy rational explanation.
Nonsense. Pierce shockycock. Shockycock. Ah! Poppycock. Superstitious drivel.
Quite probably. Oh, damn it. Damn it. Damn it.
Relax. You're all still too tense. Slow and easy does it.
Quite possibly, Lord Dudley. And yet?
And yet?
Where is Sir Percival?
Well, frankly, I'm glad he isn't here.
Why, Diana, what a thing to say.
I mean it. Sir Percival is no gentleman.
See here now. What do you say?
Every time he looks at me, I feel as though his pants were moving all over my body. What's the matter?
It's his hands, Violet. His hands.
Isn't that what I said?
You said pants.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Okay, everybody, fun is fun, but we would like Smitty to get home sometime before dawn.
Yes. Okay. Every time he looks at me, I feel as though his hands were moving all over my body.
But, that's Smitty.
That's it. Laugh it up. But let's see how funny you all think this is come tomorrow night.
Okay.
A night of the real.
He is a disgusting toad, and such toads can be lecherous at night.
Smitty!
Smitty, take it easy. You'll be just fine.
Begging your pardon, my lord, but should we delay dinner any longer?
No, I think not. Can't wait for Percival forever. Shall we, my dear?
I suppose so, but don't you think someone ought to call Percival's flat and ascertain the reason for his absence?
You know, that might be a sound idea. There is something distinctly odd about all of this.
All of what, Stephen?
This business about Sir Percival and the necklace. He did say he was bringing it tonight, Lady Margaret.
Well, actually, I...
Now what?
Well, I just thought, if Dr. Forbes gives me the necklace in the first act...
Oh, dear, I forgot to give you the new line. When I rewrote the first act a few weeks back, I forgot about that line in this act.
This is a hell of a time to think about it, Phyllis. What's the new line?
I don't have the rewrite with me.
Approximately, then. We don't have a lot of time to fool around with words. Just give us the gist and we'll improvise.
Okay. Polly's line is basically the same, only she says something to Billy about him not being here when Saul brought the necklace instead of Percival. Do you see?
Can you handle that, Polly?
I think so. Let me try.
Okay, anything to get this show moving. I need coffee. Louise, is there any coffee backstage?
For want of a better name.
Right, it'll have to do. Come along, Phyllis. The rest of you get back to work.
Take me your line again, Billy.
Right, he did say he was bringing it tonight, Lady Margaret?
Well, actually, I never spoke with him directly, but there was a message delivered this morning in the post saying that he had asked Dr. Forbes to bring it for him.
What on Saint Swithin's Day?
Wait a minute. That sounds as if it's against the law to ask somebody to deliver things on that day. The part about the post has to come last, Polly.
All right, let me try it again. Well... Dr. Forbes told me that Percival had asked him to deliver it in a message delivered this morning in the post.
Ah, much better. Go ahead, Smitty.
What, on St. Swithin's Day?
Now what?
I'm sorry, it just sounded like she couldn't.
I don't give a damn what it sounded like. If all you 3-year-olds want to play games instead of learning this show.
I'm sorry, Gerry. Go on, Smitty, please.
St. Swithin's Day.
By Jove, I never thought of that. Margaret, are you certain about that message?
Why, come to think of it, no.
So you didn't receive a message?
No, but actually, I spoke. Percival delivered it this morning in the post.
Mm-hmm. And you're not sure if it was from Percival?
Yeah, well, actually, no.
But it did come by post.
Well, I assumed it had, but...
Assumed? You mean you didn't actually see it?
Well, I come to think of it, no.
Then how did you know its content?
Well, Dr. Forbes had told me what it had said.
Is there any reason I shouldn't have?
No, of course not, old chap. Only there was no delivery of this post today.
It was not a letter, it was a telegram.
I should very much like to see that telegram.
Well, as a matter of fact, I don't have it. The message was phoned from the telegraph office.
Doris, have there been any telephone messages this evening?
See here, you insolent young pup. Are you doubting my word?
Of course he isn't, Rex. Stephen, you should apologize to Dr. Forbes.
Oh, I shall, as soon as Doris answers my question.
No, sir.
What? Are you quite sure?
The telephone has been out of order since this afternoon, Mum.
Aha. And what do you say to that, Dr. Forbes?
Damn it all to hell! Phyllis, what have you done?
What are you talking about? Did I get the phone bell out of order on a laptop?
What were you doing with the laptop, Phyllis?
Why, I just thought I'd give a listen to the sound effects.
And you deleted them all! There's nothing on the laptop! Nothing!
Oh, Louise, are you sure?
Listen for yourself!
I don't hear anything!
That's what I mean! Oh my God, I can't sleep this woman!
You're not leaving, are you?
I can't do a damn thing for you if I stay! I've got to get home, reprogram every single one of those sound effects before the opening. And if that bubble-headed idiot so much as comes near my laptop again, I'm gonna beat her head in with it!
Look, Louise, I've been thinking, since you have to do it all over again, perhaps we should hook up the telephone to a button backstage. There are so many phone calls in this show, wouldn't it be easier just to ring the telephone manually?
Well, yes, it would. Oh, and that would save me so much work tonight if I didn't have to put those rings on.
I could do the hookup.
Oh, thank you, Eddie.
Look, the end of the wire is already backstage, and there's a storage battery there, too, for power.
Okay, but fine, just make sure you put the button somewhere near the laptop so I don't have to get up to go look for it.
Of course.
Okay. And the rest of you, remember one thing. When you use the phone in the play, make sure you hang it upright. If you hang it up wrong so that the handset is not in the cradle properly, the phone's not going to ring. Got it?
Yeah, hang up the phone. Yeah,
okay.
Got it.
Now, if you'll excuse me, I've got a hell of a lot of work to do. That woman, my God, is giving me a migraine. Oh, I am so dreadfully sorry. I feel that I owe each and every one of you an apology for what I've done.
Write it down and mail it to them.
Preferably on St. Swithin's Day. Hey!
Oh, got it. How's that for fast work? Beautiful, Aggie, just beautiful. You deserve a cup of coffee for that. I'd settle for the stuff Louise brews.
Shall we go on or what?
Go on or else! It's in the queue!
Does that answer your question?
Stephen, I believe you owe Dr. Forbes an apology.
Aggie!
Sorry, I was drinking my swill!
Oh, you had best answer that, Doris, before we owe the caller an apology, too.
Yes, sir. Hello? Who? Why, yes, he is. Just a moment. It's for you, sir.
Who is it?
Sir Percival.
Can't be. I mean...
Yes, Doctor, what exactly do you mean?
Why, I...
Hello? Yes? Ah, yes. I see. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Why, Dudley, you look so strange. What did Percival say?
That was not Sir Percival. No, wait, what the hell?
Sorry, I put my coffee cup down on the bus.
Jesus.
Go on with the show, people.
That was not Sir Percival.
Then who was?
was it?
That was Miles Taylor, a good friend of mine.
Stephen, I do not understand.
Nor I.
It is very simple. I asked Miles Taylor to ring up and say that he was Sir Percival to observe the effect it would have upon Dr. Forbes. I think you can all agree that he has been struck as dumbfounded.
Nonsense. It is not nonsense, sir. I myself observed that self-same reaction.
But what does it mean?
Yes, what does it all mean?
Yes, what can it possibly mean?
Doris, you're forgetting your place.
Sorry, my lord.
I can explain what this means. It means that this man, after murdering Sir Percival for the necklace...
How dare you, sir? I'll have you in court for this. Such accusations are actionable. To tarnish my good name, it's libelous.
I cannot be sued successfully for libel should my accusations prove true.
And just how do you intend to prove them true?
Quite easily. After a look at that necklace, would you mind getting it, Dr. Forbes?
The necklace? There's no proof on that necklace. I'll show you. Aggie!
Damn it, I forgot. I'm sorry. Things have just been kind of hectic with Phyllis here, and I won't forget tomorrow, I promise. I was just in a hurry.
Heaven help us all.
From my line?
From anywhere!
I'll show you. Aggie, can't you stand a little closer?
Sorry, Saul.
There, now show me your ridiculous proof.
You yourself have shown quite the proof, Dr. Forbes, for if you are not the murderer, how did you know the combination to that safe?
Great heavens, he's right.
Blast you, Stephen Sellers, but one thing you did not take into account. I am armed. You, sir, are a scoundrel.
Oh, and I should very much like to sunder our engagement this very moment.
In that case, will you marry me, Diana?
With all my heart, Stephen.
Doris, telephone at once for the constabulary.
Do so and you're dead, my dear.
Oh, Mom, what shall I do?
Just raise your hands, and the rest of you do likewise. Aggie, the telephone's supposed to ring there.
Oh, sorry.
Jeez.
This is going to be hell tomorrow night, dashing from the safe with the necklace. Back to the soundboard to ring the thing, and then following along the script so I can cue people.
I can pass the necklace to him tomorrow night if you'd like. I'd feel much safer having it in my possession anyhow.
Won't you be seated out front?
I can come up for that part. I'll have to be backstage anyway for my bath.
Well, I don't know about all of that.
Look, we can hash all of that out later. Right now, let's just get on with the thing.
Okay. And the rest of you do likewise. Damn and blast, who's that?
It is my good friend Miles Taylor. I asked for him to ring first again, and if I do not answer, he shall summon down the law and arrive here with a warrant for your arrest. Stanley Grimes.
Stanley Grimes? Do you mean that criminal laboratory assistant to Dr. Forbes?
To the late Dr. Forbes, unless I miss my guess. Your fiendish felonies are over, Grimes. Put down that pistol and surrender yourself.
Never. I may go to the gallows, but none of you in this room will live to see it.
Please, my lord, might I leave the room?
Stand where you are. But before I destroy you all, I must know, how did you come to suspect me, Sellers?
I arrived here late, as you all know. As a result, I had time to listen to the news broadcast, was told about the finding of Sir Percival's body, dead of a rare Indian cobra poison. You, sir, had disconnected the telephone right here at the switchbox so nobody else would hear the news. But when I accidentally knocked down your overcoat, as I was hanging up my own, I found a flagon of that very poison in the pocket, and that's when I knew, of course. So, I reconnected the telephone, rang up Miles, set up our plan, and...
Excuse me, my dearest darling, but what exactly did you know when you found that foul fiend's flagon?
Why, how this man had schemed to keep alive the legend of that curse. He had immersed the cobra venom in the necklace so those who would handle it would shortly become ill. He thought in that way to devalue it, to make Lady Margaret loathe the sight of it. He then, of course, could have it for considerably less than its real value. So anxious would she be able to sell the bauble.
And I would have been too. Oh, curse you, Stanley Grimes.
Curse? There are no such things as curses. And I have soaked my hands in an antitoxin to prevent penetration of that potent poison, too. What the hell is that?
You'll get the real sirens tomorrow night.
Aha! My delaying tactics are working. The law is upon you, Stanley Grimes. Surrender yourself.
Never. I shall take this necklace, sell it for fortune, and move wealthily to another country.
curse of the Darjeeling. No, what?
Darjeeling diamond.
Oh, thank you, Henry. The curse of the Darjeeling diamond.
He's dead.
Yes. He mocked the laws of society, and now a higher power has intervened.
Oh, Stephen, hold me, hold me.
Curtain. Shall I close it, Jerry? Hell no! Bring the lights back up, Louise! Hold the lights! Hold the music! We are not done! That's your third act! Places for the top of Act One. It's already 10:30, people.
Okay.
Oh my god, my mother's going to murder me.
But my dear, it is in such a good cause.
Now we can cut the lights. Thank you.
Well, this is it, people. Any moment now, they're going to open those doors and let that audience in.
Do they have to? I'm not sure. I'm joking. I'm getting really scared.
That's good, Smitty. The worst way to approach a performance is with complacency. Nervousness gives a player energy.
Well, nervousness is giving this player creeping paralysis. Aggie may have to push me on stage.
And don't think I won't. I used to be a sergeant in the paratroops. Everybody jumped. Whether they wanted to or not.
I'm not nervous about the regular audience. If we goof, they'll probably never know. What's giving me cold sweat is the thought of looking out front and seeing you, Gerry. You'll recognize every error.
Well, don't worry. I won't be out there tonight. Tonight, I will be backstage here with Aggie, helping her push.
How come? Don't you want to see the show? Not that I blame you.
Maybe tomorrow night. Tonight, Phyllis will be out there. I don't think I can handle it. She'd want to sit next to me. That would be too much.
That reminds me. She still insists on being behind the safe to hand Saul the necklace. I mean, it saves me from busting my behind, galloping from the safe with the necklace back to help Louise with the soundboard, but I'm afraid she may get so wrapped up in listening to her play, she might forget.
If she does, this play will end with a real murder.
Well, I did it. Took me till damn near 3 o'clock in the morning, but I got all the sound effects back on the laptop and in order.
I hope you skipped the phone bells.
Don't worry, but I did add thunder and lightning effects.
But there's no thunderstorm in this play.
Who ever heard of a murder mystery without a thunderstorm? Believe me, we're gonna need it.
Louise, are you crazy? I know there's no spot in the play for a thunderstorm.
What do you want to bet?
I've been through this show 100 times. I know there's no place to hear a thunderstorm. You'll distract the actors.
Gerry, I guarantee you there is a perfect spot in this show for a thunderstorm effect, and it won't distract the actors.
Where?
That's going to be my surprise.
Louise!
Trust me, have I ever let you down?
Are you kidding me? Every single night of rehearsal, dress rehearsal?
Do yourself a favor. Bet me $1. There's one thing I love, it's a sucker bet.
What I hate about stages, there's no place to hide.
Hello, hello, hello! The magical moment's upon us at last.
And so will our audience be if we don't get the curtain closed.
Will do.
I just wanted to wish you all the best of luck.
Oh, come on!
Show business, that's bad luck to do. You're supposed to say break a leg.
Oh, I'll never understand the theater.
It's a fine thing for our playwright to say.
Oh, the audience is coming in. Would you all join me in a prayer?
Yes, yes, yes.
We can use a miracle.
St. Genesius, pray for us.
St. Genesius, pray for us.
All right, I'm going backstage. Everybody is in position. Saul, who's St. Genesius?
The patron saint of actors. He performed for the Roman emperor, and they had him put to death.
Oh, boy. Let's hope there are no emperors out front tonight.
Amen.
Lord Dudley, will there be anyone at dinner tonight besides Sir Percival, the famous archaeologist, Dr. Rex Forbes, the famous scientist, and Stephen Sellers, the famous millionaire?
Then myself and Lady Margaret, my wife, and the lovely socialite Diana Lassiter here. No Doris.
That's what I thought.
I say, Diana, have you yet located that book on the famous jewels of India that I told you must be there on the table?
Oh, yes. Here it is. I say, Lord Dudley, you didn't tell me there was a famous curse on the Ranch of Delhi. The Darjeeling Ruby Diamond.
It is known by many names, my dear.
It is. Oh, yes, certainly lots of them.
Fiddlesticks and hogwash. That curse, I mean. A damn superstitious rot. But doesn't the book distinctly say...
Yes! The book distinctly says that Lord Pike Fortescue, the first owner of the diamond, the Darjeeling diamond, was found floating in his tub.
I don't mean the diamond was found floating in the tub.
No, of course not. But what was it?
And he was in his own blood.
And the next owner?
Oh, yes, the next owner. Sir Giles Renfrew had no sooner purchased the diamond from Lord Clyde's estate when he was found floating in his stables by his favorite horse. Oh. Trampled, I mean. And then the next owner.
Balderdash, nonsense. A lot of old wives' tales.
How can it be? They're all dead. The owners, not the old wives.
Yes, but consider I bought the ruby just this morning, and I'm fine. Oh, the diamond.
Not Dudley, is anything wrong?
Everything.
No, nothing. Just another one of my beastly attacks.
You don't suppose?
Do you wonder how long I've been having them?
How long have you had them?
Since this morning.
How that long?
Don't you suppose that I suppose?
You don't suppose?
Ridiculous. The sheerest coincidence, merest chance.
Dr. Dunn is here, Lord Forbley.
Is your fiancé, Diana?
Oh, yes. Being engaged to the world's famous scientist has made me the envy of all the girls in London.
England.
In England. In London, England.
Ah, oh, but a lovely bell like you deserves to be rung.
No, have a ring. Don't you flatter me, Lord Dudley. It's your mind.
Doris, will you show the gentleman in?
Say it. Say the line.
Doris, will you show the gentleman in? Doris, will you show the gentleman in?
At once, my lord.
Doris! Lord Dudley, Diana. I can see you two lovers would like to be alone. I'll just toddle off to my room and put her about.
Yes. You're going the wrong way.
he must be going to use the outside stairway.
Yes! That must be it!
Really, Lord Dudley, you don't count? Ridiculous! I was once in love myself. Damn it! My dearest darling.
My sweet.
My darling, I have a little surprise.
I really like surprises.
I kind of thought you did.
I can't wait to find out what it is.
It's really worth waiting for.
You can't find it, huh?
I know, I must have left it in my coat. Excuse me. The necklace. Where's the damn necklace?
Phyllis has it. I forgot to get it from her.
I'm terribly sorry. Here it is. My evening gown.
Oops, a wrong surprise. I hope you're satisfied not even that before being a fruit. Here it is, the white ruby of Rancho Park, whatever the hell it is.
How incredibly lovely it is. Might I try it on?
I'm not afraid you
has.
Well, not very much, may I please?
Certainly you shall. Here, allow me. It is lovely in such a lovely setting.
Your Rex! What a thing to say!
I cannot decide which is lovelier, you or that fabulous gem.
I simply must see myself in it. Let me find a mirror.
Diana, that necklace, where is it?
It's in here.
Oh, how dare you? Take it out at once. Off at once.
I'll get it.
Oh, hurry it up.
There, Lady Margaret, I was only...
Oh, take it off at once, this instant.
Here now, Lady Margaret, there's surely no harm done.
No harm done, you say? How could you endanger the life of this dear girl and your own fiancé?
I don't believe in that silly curse, Lady Margaret. After all, it is the 20th century.
Diana, are you all right?
Started to dip, my head started to spin, but I'm quite all right now.
Lady Margaret.
Oh, well, Lady Margaret is cutting roses in the garden, Stephen. She may not return for some time.
I see. Would you mind if I wait for her here?
Naturally not.
And might I sit?
If you are so inclined.
Diana?
Yes, Stephen.
Would you take any offense if I were to...
Stephen, what are you trying to say?
Dash it all, Diana. Must we play at words? You know the message that longs to cry out from within my heart.
Is it possible? Do I dare dream that the message within your heart is the selfsame message that cries out from within my own? Your fly is open.
And yet, you do not draw away? Almost afraid to.
Then cease your noble trepidations, my dear Stephen Sellers, for although I am a high-born lady, I'm also a woman.
Oh, Diana.
Everybody, make it for act three. Play safe.
You know what, Aggie? Maybe I should have gone to that bar after all.
If you change your mind, I'll join you. Paratroops was never like this.
You know the difference between a play and a parachute?
What, Louise?
When a parachute opens, you have nothing to worry about.
Ugh.
Open the damn curtain!
Lord Dudley, you give the most charming parties in the whole of England.
You are too kind, Diana, but it is a pity Sir Percival could not be here.
Do you know I'm worried about Percival? He's never accepted an invitation to one of our parties and then not shown up, at least not without sending word.
Ah, but Lady Margaret, he might have had motor trouble.
Yes, indeed, I do hope he hasn't had an accident. These words can be treacherous at night.
Oh, don't say such a thing. It would make one think that perhaps there was some truth after all to that story about the curse.
Nonsense, my dear. There's no such thing as a keys. King is a thirst. Thing as a curse.
And yet, anyone who has ever owned the daily, the Darjeeling diamond has always met with a dreadful demise.
But Percival no longer owns the diamond anymore, not since he sold it to Lord Dudley for Lady Margaret's collection.
Nevertheless.
Aggie! Has Saul been taking a drink between acts?
What are you?
Percival did own it. That might be enough. See here, Dr. Forbes. You are a man of science. Surely you don't believe in curses?
Gerry, has Billy? Saul hates to drink alone.
Oh, dear God.
I only know there are strange things in the history of India. Things which defy rational explanation.
Ah, nonsense. Shit, cocky cock. Superstition.
superstitious dribble.
Quite possibly, Lord Dudley. And yet? Where is Sir Percival?
Well, frankly, I'm glad he isn't here.
Why, Diana, what a thing to say.
Yes, indeedy.
I'll say.
I mean it. Sir Percival is no gentleman.
See here now. What are you saying?
Every time he looks at me, I feel as though my hands were moving all over his body.
But he is a knight of the realm.
He is a disgusting toad, and such toads can be lecherous at night.
Yes, indeedy.
I'll say.
Begging your pardon, my lord, but should we delay dinner any longer?
No, I can't wait for Percival forever. Shall we, my dear?
Yes, but don't you think someone ought to call Percival's flat to ascertain the reason for his absence?
Do you know, that might be a sound idea. There is something distinctly odd about all of this.
All of what, Stephen?
This business about Sir Percival and the necklace. He did say he was wearing it tonight, Lady Margaret.
Well, actually, I never spoke with him directly, but there was a message delivered this morning on the post. In the post. On the post. The mailman brought it.
What, on Swithin's Day?
Saint Swithin's
Day.
By Jove, I never thought of that. Margaret, are you certain about that mailman or whatever you said?
No, well, actually, no.
But so you didn't receive a mailman?
The message.
That too.
Well, actually, I did, but now I wonder if it actually were from Percival.
But it did come by post?
Well, I assumed it had, but...
Assumed? You mean you didn't actually see it? Him. The message. Or the mailman.
Whatever it was, no.
Then how did you know its content?
Like Dr. Forbes had told me what he had said.
Yes, indeedy.
Is there any reason why you shouldn't have?
Is there any reason I shouldn't have?
No, of course not, old chap.
Then why'd you ask?
If only there was no delivery of this post today, but then how?
It was not a letter, it was a telephone. Cable car. Telegram.
I should very much like to see that telegram.
Oh, man, I haven't got it. Oh. As a matter of fact, the message was phoned from the telegraph office.
Doris, have there been any telephone messages this evening?
See here, you innocent young punk. Are you doubting my word?
Of course he isn't, Rex. Of course he isn't, Rex.
Stevens.
Of course he isn't, Stephen.
Should I apologize to Dr. Forbes?
Yes. Thank you.
I shall as soon as...
I'm Doris.
Right! As soon as Doris answers my question.
What was the question?
What was the question?
Someone must know.
Damn if I do.
No, me neither.
Doesn't anyone know?
No, sir.
No, what?
That's the answer to the question.
What? I'm quite sure.
The telephone has been out of order since this afternoon. Mum.
Aha! And what do you say to that, Dr. Forbes?
Oh, damn it!
Does that answer your question?
Stephen, I believe you owe Dr. Forbes an apology.
Doris. You must answer that.
Before we owe the collar an apology too.
Yes, damn it, yes!
Yes, sir, you bet. Hello? Who? Why, yes, he is. Just a moment. It's you, sir.
Hello? What? Who is it?
Sir.
Yes? Yes. Oh, yes, I see. Thank you. Thank you very much.
It can't be, I mean...
You mean it can't be Sir Percival, right?
All right.
Yes, Doctor, what exactly do you mean?
I...
Polly?
Oh, yes, all right. Oh, Dudley, You look so strange. What did Percival say?
That was not Sir Percival.
Then who was it?
That was a good friend of mine. I can't remember his name.
Miles Taylor.
Right!
Stephen, I do not understand.
Nor I.
I can explain what this means. It means that this man, after murdering Sir Percival for the next... Wait. Do I say he was struck dumbfounded?
I do. I still saw, observe the self-same reaction, I think.
Yes, what can it possibly mean?
Doris, you're forgetting your place.
She's not the only one.
Where the hell are they?
Search me.
Doris, you're forgetting your place? How dare you, sir? I'll have you in court for this. Such accusations are actionable. To tarnish my good name, it's libelous.
I shall not be sued successfully for libel should my accusations prove true.
And just how do you intend to prove them true?
Quite easily. After a look at that necklace. Would you mind getting it, Dr. Forbes?
The necklace? There's no proof on that necklace, I assure you. It must be in here someplace. Are you sure this is where you put it, Margaret?
Like where else?
Why don't you have another look?
All right. Now show me your ridiculous proof.
You yourself have shown quite the proof, Dr. Forbes. For if you are not the murderer, how did you know the combination to that safe?
Great heavens.
Stephen Sellers, but there is one thing that you did not take into account. That I am armed. You, sir, are a scoundrel.
And I should very much like to sunder our engagement this very moment.
In that case, will you marry me, Violet?
Yes, Billy!
I mean, Diana.
Doris, telephone me at once to the constabulary.
Do so and you're dead, my dear.
Mom, what shall I do?
Just raise your hands, and the rest of you do likewise.
Did you say, and the rest of you do likewise?
Yes. Hang up the phone.
What? Hang up the phone!
Hey, damn and blast, who's that?
It is my good friend Miles Taylor. I asked for him to ring for us again, and if I do not answer, he shall summon the law down here and have a warrant here for your arrest. Stanley Grimes!
Stanley Grimes!
So put down that pistol and surrender!
Never! I shall take this necklace, sell it for a fortune, and move wealthily to another country.
Oh, curse you, Stanley Grimes! It's the curse of the Delhi diamond.
The Ranjipo diamond.
The Darjeeling diamond.
All of them. He's dead.
Given my modest effort here tonight. But I would like to discuss with you the state of the...